Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
We're going to have the second invited talk today. So it's our pleasure to have David Evans speaking. David is a professor at the University of Virginia. He's worked in many different areas in security, so in wireless networks, sensor networks, especially in software security, a lot of work there. He's also been very active in computer science education. He's been working with Udacity, which is one of the big online, massive online courses, MOOCs. So he's teaching an intro to computer science class and a cryptography class as well. So David has also written a book, An Introduction to Computer Science, which is really nice, and I think is freely available. So if you want to check that out, you should. And of course, sort of more relevant to this audience, he's done a lot of work on applied multi-party computation, and he's worked on the fast Garble circuit framework, and also done work on privacy and intersection, and has looked at how to generate circuits for MPC. And also, I guess, one of his students has a talk this afternoon on data oblivious computation as well. So with that, I'll let him get started.
Okay. Well, thank you, Sandy. Much appreciate the introduction, especially the plug for my book. And I actually have a new book that just released this week that I'm going to plug later. So I take that as permission that I can plug my book. There were a lot of interesting technical talks yesterday, and more interesting additional interesting technical talks today. I won't presume which ones are going to be more interesting. I'm going to try to balance that by not having anything technical at all in my talk. So I hope you'll be okay with that. Yehuda asked for a proof, but I'm afraid I won't have one. Yes, I guess it is a self-proving talk. Several people wondered about my title, why 2029? And this is a good question, so I should try to explain that. And there's an obvious answer to that, that it's 15 years from now. So why 15 years? And there are lots of answers to this. The one I'm going to give is actually from a talk that Neil deGrasse Tyson gave at a conference about 15 years ago, and it got turned into an essay, which I do have posted on my site. I hope people will read this. But what he talks about is this inevitable progress in science, having this golden age. And he explains it by talking about going into the library at Princeton. And he's an astrophysicist, so he was looking at the astrophysics journals and trying to figure out, you know, what the rate of new knowledge is. And so he went into the library and he tried to figure out where the midpoint of the width of all the journals is. And he found that was 15 years ago. And so 15 years ago was halfway. And then he figured, well, what's the midpoint between here and there? And that was also 15 years ago. And kept doing this and found that, you know, the amount of knowledge, if you can measure it by the thickness of this astrophysical journal, which I guess in astrophysics is a reasonable way to measure knowledge, was doubling every 15 years. And that keeps going. And there are lots of reasons for this. We talk about Moore's Law a lot in computing and saying, well, maybe Moore's Law is running out. But there are lots of other things that will extend beyond that. And there are lots of things that happened before that, that whether it's the printing press or telephones or getting on airplanes, things that make it easy for people to communicate and keep track of knowledge, or ways that you can build on previous work. There are lots of reasons why fields like science, astrophysics, and computing, and MPC are all experiencing exponential growth and endless golden ages. So in order to look at my predictions for the next 15 years, we want to start by going back a little bit and see what happened in the last two doublings. And if you look just to measure the state of where we are now, this is just the search for all the, oops. Maybe my inking is But I don't really need. So this is all the papers that have multi-party computation in their title or abstract in the last year, and there's about 700 of them. And I talked yesterday on the panel that we're writing too many papers. I don't know. I have not read all 700, so there may be some gems in there that we've all missed. But if anyone has read all 697 of them, my guess is the average quality is probably pretty small. Or at least the average size of contribution is probably pretty small if we're able to make that many papers in a year. So if we go back 15 years to 1999, there were 162 papers in the 15 years between 1985 and 1999. So that fits pretty well. Actually, it's much more rapid than the doubling amount of content that Neil deGrasse Tyson was talking about in astrophysics. But there were some really important papers being written in that era. And the one that I'll highlight that I think is quite interesting for this talk. So Shafi Goldwasser gave a talk at PODCI in 1997 talking about the past and present of multi-party computations. And she was smart enough not to put a date on her predictions about the future. But was talking about, you know, we believe the field is today where public key crypto was 10 years ago. So this was would be where public key crypto was in 1987. And an extremely powerful tool in rich theory whose real-life usage is at this time only beginning. And so I think that is probably a good prediction for today rather than 1997. So I could end my talk there and not risk making any of my own predictions. But I think I have another 40 minutes, so I won't do that. OK, so that was 1997. Let's go back another 15 years. What were people doing in 1984? Well, there were, at least according to Google Scholar, 8 results. You'll see one that Payman was already working in multi-party computing back in 1908. So I wasn't aware of that until doing the search. But apparently his record in this field goes back further than we understood. Okay, so going back to 1969, we had things that were a little different in terms of multi-party computation. But this was really when computing started to get cheap and practical. This is the investment by NASA to build the control for the Apollo guidance computer as well as for ICBMs was what got integrated circuits and started a lot of what made computing practical enough that everyone can use it. So you have to go back a few doublings to get to that. And the free NOR gate required quite a bit of silicon back then. OK, so now that we've gone back a little bit, we should try to go forward. And that's what I'm going to do the rest of the talk. So where should we be in 2029? And there's been a lot of investment in this area. It's fairly hard to get a really good, accurate estimate. But it's order of $100 million or so, I think. And that's just in the US and probably another 100 million in the rest of the world. So that's enough that we should expect something pretty big to come of this. For comparison, that's about what the government spends on art, dance, literature, music, museums, opera, and visual arts and theater in a year is what's getting spent on our community. So that's a good question. So this is probably over more than 1 year. Right, and we're comparing here over a year, but not more than 2 or 3 years. And it would be good, and maybe someone with more understanding of how funding agencies work can figure out more accurately what the spend per year. But I would say the spend per year is at least $50 million, the spend over the last 3 years is definitely at least $100 million. Okay, now before we get too embarrassed about not making contributions at the level of music, opera, theater, art, and literature. We can also compare it to snow removal, which last week cost more than all of this. And if they just wait a couple weeks, it all goes away. So that really seems like a waste compared to what we're doing. But the taxpayers making these investments should be expecting to get something pretty big out of it. And for us, you know, acceptable results for that, well, we're academics. You know, it's acceptable to us, at least at some level, if what we're getting out of it is lots of fun, intellectually interesting problems to work on and exciting results to learn about and getting to go to meetings in nice sunny places with beaches like Seattle and all those kinds of good things that make our lives fun as researchers. For the taxpayers, that's probably not enough. Right? Really, something should be coming out of this that will create a multi-billion dollar industry and things that, you know, regular people can relate to as making their lives better. So I think we're quite a long way from doing that. So I'll make my first bold claim, and I'm calling my things claims instead of predictions because that's a little safer. So my claim is that the industry that grows out of multi-party computation by 2029 should be bigger than the malware industry. And I should clarify, I mean the anti-malware industry, not the pro-malware industry, which is much smaller. We shouldn't have any trouble getting bigger than the pro-malware industry. And if you look at how big that is today, according to Gartner, it's about $70 billion a year, all the IT security, which I'm counting as mostly anti-malware. So if that continues growing at the rate they expect, or the rate that it has the last few years, that means we need to, you know, create a few $100 billion of value. Putting that in context, Microsoft last year, revenue was about $77 billion. So creating three or four, maybe two companies about the size of Microsoft would be doing this. Claudio is laughing at my prediction. Now, there's an easier way to achieve this, which is why I'm more confident in this prediction, which is that maybe what should happen is the anti-malware industry should become much less relevant as we actually learn how to make software systems that are not quite so vulnerable. And I'm actually pretty optimistic about this curve being something like that. So we may not need to create a couple $100 billion to make this prediction true. Okay. I'm not going to try to draw it. Yeah. This is the line for the IT security industry, not for Microsoft's. I would not presume to predict what's going to happen to Microsoft over the next 15 years. So the next claim I'm going to make is that the perceived high cost is no longer the real main impediment to widespread use of secure multi-party computation, at least if we're talking about two parties. So to explain why I think this, I'm going to go back to the motivating problem that Yehuda used yesterday, which I think is sort of the most compelling example of multi-party computation. Just to remind you, so this is the scenario where two people meet in some drinking establishment and they want to decide whether it's worth pursuing this archaic courtship ritual, and they want to know if they have a good chance of having successful, healthy children if things go in that direction. So they want to do a secure computation with their mobile devices and figure out, you know, either they have, you know, the green light and their offspring have a good chance of being healthy, or get the warning and save themselves the effort. So the fact that we're talking about this as our canonical example, and I hope everyone is, not just Yehuda and me, is a real sign of progress in our field. Right, so if you go back the previous 30 years, you know, the motivating problem was this millionaires problem that Andrew Yao introduced, of the two millionaires that want to figure out who's richer without revealing their income or their net worth. And this moving up to the genetic dating application is a big advance on that, both because, you know, it's actually doing some interesting computation. It's not just a less than comparison. But it's also a real practical application, unlike this one, which I don't think anyone actually wants to do. And I used to think it was just a toy application, and I talked about this before as a toy application, and then someone pointed out to me that there actually is a real app for this. And It's quite popular in Iceland, apparently. I don't know if we have any Icelanders here. They actually won an award for it. And you can read the review. You can note the use of probably in the So this is a important motivating problem. And what I'm going to look at is the cost of actually doing this. And part of it is having your genome sequenced, right? That the app in Iceland, everyone's pretty closely related, and they have a national database, not of complete genomes, but of enough genetic information to actually do that. But they're actually just doing it based on known relationships, not on genetics. But the cost of sequencing a genome, if you look at that going back to about 2000 is when the Human Genome Project concluded and declared victory and said we've sequenced either Craig Venter's genome or some mix of 12 other people's genome, depending on which version of the project. They think won, and they sort of declared a tie. And that was projected, to cost about $1 billion, and the cost for sequencing one genome was around 100 million in 2001, and was going down very well along this path that you would predict from just the Moore's law decrease in computing cost. And then things really changed. Right? So this is mostly due to improvements in algorithms, but also due to some improvements in biochemistry and other things, and you see the cost really plummeted. You can see it sort of stopped dropping and started actually going up. And the way the NIH is estimating this cost, it actually includes the administrative cost of doing it as well. So it's probably going to mostly go up from now. And it's also sort of fuzzy, what it means to actually sequence a genome, because you've got to look at how much coverage you do and how much you actually read. And when you do sort of the 23andMe and it's less than $100 to do it, they're definitely not sequencing the whole genome. And they're doing it more at the useful for recreation level, not useful for medicine. OK, so let's try to put the cost of doing the secure computation that is comparing the genomes on here. And this is, as we talked about last time, benchmarking is really hard. And it's hard to sort of extract from papers what the actual cost of doing some other application is. So I've done the best I can to try to extrapolate that. Don't read too much into the specific numbers I have here, because there's lots of guesswork. But it would be roughly in 2004 when FairPlay was released and was in many ways the first system to try to do real computation as an MPC, it would have cost about $100 million to do this comparison between two genomes. And that cost has really plummeted. And to today, we're probably the same thing would cost orders of a tenth of a cent or so. So this is doing a few billion gates to execute this computation. And there's lots of reasons the cost has dropped. Right? Some of it is just the cost of computing dropping. So that's maybe an order of magnitude here. Some of it is the improvements in how to do the garbling and how much less expensive it is with techniques like just garble. And some of it is making the circuit smaller. But the combined impact of all of that is taking something that used to be $100 million down to a fraction of a cent. Now, this is all semi-honest. So if we want to add the active level security or fully malicious security, we need to make our chart go up a little higher to fit it in. And probably it would have been orders of $10 billion or so for Alice and Bob to do this if they really didn't trust each other back in 2004. So probably was not too practical. But that cost is also really plummeted. And if the batching that Yehuda talks about can be applied to this scenario, and I guess that depends a lot on Bob's activities, whether the batching up to 1,000 works, then the cost is really, really getting down to fractions of cents, even for active level security. So of course, there are computations that we want to do that are larger and more complicated than this. And cost is still a factor there, But there should be lots of interesting computations where the cost of doing it as a secure multi-party computation is very low. And we should be wondering, given that, why are we not seeing lots of actual MPC applications deployed? So I think there are some costs that still matter. And none of these answer that question of why we're not seeing MPC applications deployed yet, at least on any large scale. So that all of these results are for two-party, and scaling beyond two parties is still very expensive. And that's something where most of the techniques that are designed to scale to many parties, maybe they scale to three or four, but become horrendously impractical beyond that. And lots of interesting applications need millions of parties. And Mari talked about yesterday, trying to scale to things like Twitter and social networks where you've got millions of parties. And there are plenty of interesting applications that require that. The other cost that I don't think we'll ever get rid of, and this I think is important for the uses of MPC where people talk about outsourcing computation or using a service where you're keeping your data encrypted, is the energy cost. I don't see any way to get the energy cost down to sort of at least less than a factor of 1,000 above regular computation. That just the cost, as long as you're doing any kind of protocol like anything we're familiar with today, the energy cost is going to be thousands of times higher. And energy is a big part of the actual cost of running the data center. So in order to make the business case, and hope we'll hear more about this on the panel later today, for lots of these applications, the energy cost, if the customers aren't willing to pay thousands of times as much to have it done securely, which for most applications where what the customers are getting is privacy, that's probably a very hard sell. Data centers are already using 1 or 2% of all the energy. If we scaled that by a factor of 1,000 to make everything an MPC, then that's an awful lot of energy. The other things that I think do matter, and this is why even the sort of simple applications like our genetic dating or equivalent are not really useful in practice today and not getting widely deployed, are these kinds of questions. So our model, and as both theoreticians and practitioners in this field, we always make this assumption that your goal is to not leak anything when you do the computation, and then you get to the end of it and you blast this output out that probably reveals a lot of things you might not want someone to infer from the sensitive data you started with. And so I think that's a really important question to try to understand. Are there ways to measure or limit or at least reason about how much information the adversary could infer from what gets released as the output? And I think that's an area where there's very little progress in understanding that or figuring out how to do that. The other thing, at least for a lot of scenarios, is if you want an end user to understand and get some value from this, there has to be some way to convey that or to make that meaningful to them. And my example of this, we built a sort of a toy application, maybe a little less toy than the genetic dating one, where you would be able to compare your contact lists. And two people with their mobile phones would be able to find out if they know anyone in common and otherwise not reveal anything about their contact list. And this was a nice demo, and it took about a minute or two to run back a couple years ago when we were first showing it, and that was enough time to show a little animation on the screen and be able to tell people, here's why this is so cool, and you're getting all these extra privacy guarantees. Unfortunately, phones got faster, and so if you do this now, it only takes a few seconds, and then no one believes that anything as interesting is going on. So maybe the way to convey end user value is to have like long timeouts and animations. And I know there are commercial products that do this, have the sort of progress bar running the super, super duper encryption. So the longer that takes, the more confident your users are. I hope that is not the answer for us. And the third reason is it still requires a lot of expertise and a lot of effort and a lot of work to build an MPC system, especially one if you want to actually do the entire system, not just the part of the computation that we tend to focus on. So to build an end-to-end system that includes a user interface or whatever it includes to make it meaningful and connects with all the things that are necessary to make a real application. So those things involve a lot of work, and I don't think much has... There's been some progress in reducing that cost, but it's still very high. Okay, so my third claim is that we don't yet know what the killer app for MPC is, and maybe we'll get some more insight at the business panel today. But I think most of the apps that we talk about are probably not the thing that's going to get MPC widely deployed. And it's probably not really privacy, right? I think a lot of us, including me, are motivated to work in this area because we care about individual privacy and want to empower individuals to be able to interact with services or other people in ways that give them control over their data. The reality is the value and the amount people will pay for that is very little. So unless there's some magic way to get over this factor of 1,000 energy cost, it would be great to have sort of a privacy-preserving version of our webmail or search engines, all of these things. But unless people are willing to pay for them in some other way than having them free with advertising, it seems really hard to make that successful. Okay, so I'm going to show a little movie that hopefully will get people thinking about what that killer app should be. I don't know what it is, but I hope someone here will be able to tell me before the end of the talk today, or at least by the end of the day. So.
Have you ever borrowed a book from thousands of miles away, across the country,
gesture ahead, take next,
without stopping for directions, or sent someone a fax from the beach? You will. And the company that'll bring it to you, AT&T. Have you ever paid a toll without slowing down? Bought concert tickets from cash machines? Or tucked your baby in from a phone booth? You will.
So there's more of those and in some ways, you know, AT&T was very prescient about lots of things, but there's this weird kind of irony of all the things they're talking about don't actually exist today and have disappeared, that we don't know what phone booths are anymore or faxes. And I have my students in my operating system class last semester watch some of these ads and complete a survey about which ones of them they had actually done. And there's obviously some fuzziness how you interpret these things. The one that actually got the lowest rating was not in the clips that I showed you, but was doing business in a language that you don't understand. I think this is probably mostly because the students aren't yet actually doing business. In terms of the automatic translation, that's definitely something people perceived as a very hard problem. And this quote, which is often misattributed to Niels Bohr, I'm sure people have heard it before. If you don't speak Danish, you can, of course, translate it and get a pretty good translation automatically. It certainly is difficult to make translations. I don't know if there will be a secure multi-party computation way of doing automatic translation in the future, but maybe that would be a nice application to be able to get a service to translate for you without telling them what you want translated. I'm not sure there's a business case for it, though, but it could be nice. Okay, so before I wrap up, I want to mention a little bit. So we had this panel yesterday on theory versus practice, and Heyman wanted to get this, you know, battle between myself and Yehuda going, and I think I was supposed to represent practice in that, although it's a little murky. And part of my, I certainly am more of a systems person than a theory person, but I have now written a theory of computation book, so my loyalties are much less clear. And I'm not sure if many people here are that the target audience for my book, because it's not quite at the graduate level. It's more targeted to 2 or 3 year olds, but it's definitely something that I hope many of you would read and appreciate. If anyone does have a 2 or 3 year old who is behind on her theoretical computer science education and is willing to admit this in front of this audience, I do have a few copies to give away today. So, okay. Oh, we have some takers. Good. Okay.
Awesome.
Those who don't get copies, you can buy one on Amazon.com. Okay. So one last copy, highest bidder?
Yeah.
Okay, you're closest. Okay. And for those not getting copies, I also have some flyers, which is not quite as good as a copy, but... Oh, I have one more copy. Did you have a fire copy? Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. This is your consolation prize. And... you can post those around Microsoft. You know, since it was just released this week, I don't have a lot of reviews to show you yet, but I do have one from the founder of Microsoft Corporation. So I hope that will convince people they should definitely read my book. And I apologize, I have not yet updated it to support mini Lego. It only works for large full-size Legos. But maybe after the talk yesterday, we'll have a mini Lego version. Okay, so how do we find the killer app for multi-party computation? And as I said, I don't know what it is, but I hope people in this room will start thinking about it. And most of what we are doing is sort of what that AT&T commercial was doing, right? We're doing things like sending faxes from the beach, taking things that people do today and saying, let's add a little bit, maybe a little or a lot of privacy to that. Right? So we're sending faxes from the beach or tucking babies in from phone booths, things that look like pretty silly predictions today. And I hope that there are applications for MPC, and what the ultimate killer applications for it will be are things that enable people to do things they're not doing today, not add some privacy to things that they're already doing. And as two examples, these go back, you know, before the AT&T commercial. You know, Tim Berners-Lee was creating the World Wide Web. Nicholas Negroponte, and this is going back two doublings, back 30 years ago, was talking about multi-touch interfaces with pressure sensitivity. So I would be happy to take questions. If anyone has ideas what that killer app for MPC is, I would be very happy to hear about them. Yes?
Cost up and does the secure
how did I make up my numbers for my slide?
Yeah.
So it's pretty hard to get accurate numbers. That's why the line is really thick and fuzzy. I did my best to look at to try to figure out the cost per gate and the number of gates and scale that, and then looked at the cost of computing on EC2 as sort of scaling the cost of computing. There's certainly, I wouldn't place a lot of faith in the actual numbers that I came up with, whether it's a tenth of a cent or actually the more recent ones are probably more accurate because we do have more, I guess, closer to benchmarks that match what I'm doing. But whether it's $100 billion or, you know, $50 billion to do the active security version, I wouldn't have a lot of confidence in, but it's definitely, you know, orders of tens of billions. Not, you know, a few millions. Yeah.
Sometimes wind is generating electricity when nobody's there to use it. Could you have batch processing for MPC to be used when the windmill would otherwise have to be cut down?
So the question is, yeah, if the problem is energy costs, can we take advantage of things like batch processing and offline processing to do things when energy is cheaper? We could. There's probably lots of other things people, you know, there's always something people can do with that energy. So if there's nothing more useful that people can do with it than do an MPC. Maybe that's what it could be used for. But maybe you know, if you can do all that instead of worrying about a factor of 10,000 more expensive, it turns out to be more like 1,000. But I think it's still pretty hard, and most of the interesting applications do seem to have some part that latency is important for. So if you can do everything else offline, that part that latency is important for is still a factor of 1,000 or 10,000 more expensive.
Well, yes. This is already done with dynamic energy pricing, right? So your windmill will be connected and the price at night will be cheaper. You can do it
right. And computing, you know, the spot prices on on EC2, probably on Azure. I don't know.
Your 10,000x, probably reflects the real thing, but the application that you'll be running is not sensitive. You know, most of it will be maybe 99.something% will be not privacy sensitive. So if you have a small thing like comparing your contacts, payment transaction, that's a small thing relative
right. to Yeah, that's a very good point. And I think part of the difficulty in building sort of real applications that use MPC is to figure out how to connect the small part of our computation that really needs to be done securely with all the things that don't need to be done securely and balance that cost. So I think if it is the case that, you know, that the actual part that needs to be secure is, you know, a 0.1% of the total cost of your computation, and you increase that cost by a factor of 1,000, then maybe it's only doubling the total cost, and that's okay. Or it could be an even smaller fraction. So no one has the killer application to tell me?
The thing is, if you have a killer application,
Oh, we're all fins here. It's okay. You can tell me after, though, if you're holding it out on us.
Yeah. What do you think about the complexity of development? There's a lot of these protocols are very complicated.
Yes.
You see that as a barrier. You see that as well. There's a lot of software there. Okay, it's not an issue. What's your...
It's certainly an issue. So I think having libraries like SCAPI and the tool that Sammy's going to talk about later today may be part of that. So part of it, you know, software development is expensive. The problem with developing an MPC is it's not normal software development. You need expertise in cryptography, and there's a big risk of if you get some little thing wrong, you've lost all these security properties you're trying to get. And this is true for all cryptographic software development, that it is much harder than regular software development. It's hard enough, but now that you've got to implement crypto correctly, it gets much harder. And then the issues with, you know, maybe the cost will be low enough that you don't have to worry about doing the kinds of low-level optimizations that you need to get an MPC to be reasonably efficient today. So that will reduce the cost a lot, or maybe more of that can be automated. But I think I think at least for this deployment question, a lot of it is if you can separate your application in a way that only a small part of it needs to be done as an MPC and the rest of it can be done by your, you know, lowly paid regular software engineers, and they won't mess up the security properties that you're trying to get from the part that you're doing securely. But I think that's still a hard problem.
So with protocols like TLS and SSH, you know, these are ways that crypto gets into the mainstream, but sometimes they get into the mainstream and they lose like the provable guarantees, and then cryptographers have to follow along afterwards and try to prove the security of these bizarre protocols. Do you worry about that for MPC, or how can we avoid that?
So where security tends to get broken in the real world is not the mathematics of the protocols and encryption systems. It's in flaws in the implementation, or someone gets a keylogger installed on their machine and everything they type gets recorded. It doesn't matter how secure everything after that is. And I think this is definitely an issue for MPC, that at least lots of these applications, you end up with a client program that an end user types their sensitive data into and is trusting to execute this protocol correctly. And as sort of researchers in crypto, we think of trust as, well, you're not trusting, the fact that you don't have to trust the other person's client means you've achieved your threat model goal. And of course, can trust all the code that you run yourself because you wrote it yourself. Or and it doesn't use any underlying libraries or run on any untrusted machine or anything else. But I think for at least many of the apps people talk about for secure computation, the big risk to their data is not in the execution of the MPC, it's in all the things that happen around that. And I think it sort of may be one of the reasons that it doesn't make sense to deploy this widely yet is if you can't solve those problems, increasing the cost of the part of the computation that's probably not going to get broken in the first place by a factor of 1,000 is not the best place to put your resources. But if you remember that the line that I have of the sort of drop of the malware industry, I'm actually quite optimistic that some of those things will actually get better. Yeah.
So you mentioned that you think the killer app for MPC should be something adding privacy to what you can already do, but something new that you're not doing, right? So I like this concept, but it's hard for me to imagine MPC doing this because whatever I think MPC can do, you could also always do it non-securely, right? So it seems like privacy will always be the motivation for using NPC.
So I'll mention one example that Yehuda's working on is if you're running a service where you've got to maintain lots of accounts and you've got users and passwords, or you're acting as a proxy for someone and you've got to manage a bunch of keys, what you would like to do so you don't become the next, I won't pick a particular, we've all heard of companies that have had their encrypted password file exposed, and that is a big risk. And so what you want to do is store that file on two machines that are very separate in different jurisdictions, running different operating systems, running different stacks of everything that you can make different, and use an MPC between those two machines to validate a login. So you're not having any one machine that if someone compromises it, they get your password database. So that's, I think, an example where you're providing some important security property using MPC, but it's not privacy for end users in the way we usually think about privacy.
Okay, when you're saying privacy, most for end users you were thinking, right?
And this is privacy in the sense that the organization that wants to split up its passwords in this way started knowing all the data. So there's no enhanced privacy by using MPC. It's enhanced protection. Now, if you believe my claim that the malware industry is going to become unnecessary, then maybe that is not necessary anymore, but it certainly would be valuable to do for the foreseeable future.
I think the issue is also there's a slightly different mindset here in that we always think about securitization as being two different parties with different data who want to cooperate. And here we're talking about a single party who just can't trust the network. So actually there's a different mindset there as well.
So it's not Alice and Bob.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was going to comment on the same topic because the main problem that we have nowadays is that systems are broken because usually they are, people can break bad encryption, but they will compromise the machine. And we all have a lot of computing devices these days. We have like one or two cell phones and a laptop and so on. And this scenario where you think of one person trying to add more resilience to their computing network.
Yeah,
like this.
So you would like your three devices that you're carrying around all day to do a MPC for when you want to read your email or something there.
Like a single honest party that will be compromised only if all the subtopics
are compromised. So if someone steals your phone, if it's not near your other devices, there's nothing that can be exposed.
You are still fine.
And I think that's an interesting application. I haven't thought of it too much whether MPC is really necessary for that or That, but I think at the as if you want to take it to the extent that there's never any key on the device that could be exposed, then MPC probably is necessary for it.
So. I mean, you can think that the application might ever use MPC as an authentication mechanism. If you have your three devices and they could bind to act as a password manager. Mm-hmm. So the password is almost never or never exposed on any one device, as an example of how that works.
And you could you're using that to authenticate yourself to some other system,
right?
And by proving you have those three devices, right. That gives them a lot of confidence. That, yeah, I think
that. And you store awesome. Passwords and shares.
And you can be entering password into two of the devices as part of that process.
Yeah.
Yes.
If you compare MPC with public key, in the 70s, the U.S. Navy did not use public key as a war spy ring had its liver on toast for breakfast. Is there any equivalent to not using MPC right now and bad things happening?
So I think the military was still hand-distributing keys, at least they may still be, but at least as of 5 years ago, I knew that they were, that they had people whose job it was to carry a key out to someone else to make keys. I don't know if that's changed in the last 5 years. So the question is there something like that with MPC where you can say, people are doing things in a very expensive, time-consuming, unsatisfying way because they're not using MPC. Did you have an idea?
No.
Oh.
Dating in bars.
Sorry?
What? Dating in bars.
The genetic dating. Well,
epigenetic.
Yes. Okay. We have our killer application, but yeah, I'm not sure that fit.
So, when you made the history of MPC, you Google MPC, but then most of the other things you said were about two-party computation. So clearly the dating example, okay. No, never mind.
I think the batch processing is enough there without worrying about the multi-party issues.
So when you looked at the performances, we can do things very well when we assume honest majority, when we have settings with honest party. So, the killer application will be a two-party computation and multi-party computation.
I think that's a good point. I didn't try to get more than two parties onto my cost estimate because I really have. I don't think it's even possible to figure out what the cost of a. There are some implementations of three-party, but very little that has been done beyond that. I think a lot of the interesting applications are things like maybe auctions and voting that people talk about that do require scaling to millions of parties and are usually done instead by having sort of a small number, like the beat auction where all the parties give their data to someone they trust.
Right, right.
And then.
But that could be the same with the example with the keys, right? When the keys, sharing the keys among your machines.
Right, if you have more than. So that's probably still a small number scaling to, 20 machines, but and the things that involve sort of social networks and expanding to every individual involved in some large computation, I think those are still there. There's definitely the costs are many, many orders of magnitude beyond what would make that accessible. So I think there are some big theoretical breakthroughs needed before we can really think about making that practical. But there definitely are killer applications that would be enabled by having millions of people, millions of parties in MPC. Yeah.
I think the good things about MPC is that sometimes having a lot of parties help you instead of being a risk or being a bad thing. Because when you have a large number of parties, then the cost for each party is going to break down to a lot of number of parties. And if you can design a scalable algorithm, the cost is something like the shape of the cost is decreasing with the number of parties. And it's really maybe helpful because, for example, you cannot have MPC for maybe four people, but you may have MPC for 2 to 100 people or 2 to 15 people because then each person do a little work to.
So I think if there and the things that you're working on are maybe a good step in that direction, I think the more traditional MPC protocols don't scale like that.
Yeah.
That the total work is scaling exponentially or.
That's not true.
That's not true.
The ones. No. When the shy has all these works on scalable MPC. where the part the work per part goes down.
And the offline work as well?
Honest majority.
Okay. So that's good. So there may be cases. And the other thing I would say that argues in favor of more parties is this question of what the output reveals. If you've got two parties and you know one party is malicious and they're able to control their data, they can probably come up with inputs that are going to reveal what they want about the other party's data. If you've got many parties involved in the computation and you're revealing an output that's an aggregate of all those parties, you're much safer as any individual participating in it that your personal data won't be leaked in the output. So I think there are definitely some big advantages of increasing the number of parties.
Although that said, that's essentially an argument for security by obscurity.
Not really, because it's the question of what you can infer from the output. So you're going to have information theoretic strong claims that what you can infer if it's a two-party, one party can infer everything about the other party's data from the input. If it's a three-party and there's no collusion, then one party might be able to infer something but not know which of the two parties is the one that has that leak mark in their data. So I think there are pretty strong claims you can make about as long as you have a strong assumption about non-collusion, which is hard in the real world, you can make some much stronger claims about what gets leaked. I guess it's both non-collusion and not having any outside information that you can use to infer more than you get from just that. Yeah.
So maybe this is related to the previous question, but do you think when we want to move to many parties, there will be some considerably different constraints between the cases of 2 to 3 parties and millions of parties? For example, would interaction be still feasible?
Yeah.
When we talk about millions of parties?
So definitely if your application is a social network where you're sharing data and doing computation that involve data from all the participants, you wouldn't want to require that everyone in the network is available online to do that computation. So I think there are interesting questions about whether delegation is the answer or being able to do things offline and asynchronously. I don't know much about the work that's being done on that, but I think probably quite different protocols are going to be needed for some of these scenarios.
I believe it's better to use asynchronous. Sorry, I'm not that much big in the community, but I believe it's better to design asynchronous algorithm because you cannot afford everybody be online. But in some application, you can afford to wait for the result. Mm-hmm. For example, you can afford to wait for, I don't know, one day to for your payment to be checked in. It's still in banking system. You can wait for some hours or one day for your payment to be approved by the bank system. So you can wait for the application and make sure that everybody is going to be online during some period of that time.
I think people accept waiting for banking transactions to be slow just because that's always been the way they are. But we shouldn't accept them being slow. They should happen very quickly.
Aside
to your comment, there are things where latency and things are important, and there are things you could do in offline analysis. Absolutely.
Waiting for them now today, and they are used to it. So you can have an application that waiting is a really.
If you're trying to do something with a social network with millions of participants, and you've got to wait until everyone does some online interaction, you may be.
Not really, but for example, a good partition of them. Mm-hmm. For example.
Right. So if it's 2/3 of people, I think that's awesome.
Maybe some application that would help Bitcoin verification. Because.
So do you need MPC to help Bitcoin verification?
Of course.
It's a public ledger. There's no.
So you can't break in and steal your keys. How are you protecting your keys?
So not the verification of the blockchain, but the protecting your own Bitcoin wallet. I think that makes sense.
You could use HSMs, but the Bitcoin community doesn't want to touch HSMs.
It is a crypto savvy community. It's worth thinking about. I'm not sure if they're the killer. I guess Bitcoin has to become a killer app before something that aids Bitcoin itself could be a killer app. But it's not clear to me whether Bitcoin's on that path or not.
Are you planning to write a book on multi-party computations for toddlers?
So what's the sequel to Dorian Meek and the Universal Machine? I have not figured out the sequel yet. I think I was thinking quantum computation would probably be the next, but maybe multi-party would be the third. But at least as maybe she'll be old enough by then that you know I'll be able to use more challenging concepts in the book. But we'll see. I don't have an idea. If someone has an idea. I can help you find a good illustrator.
Do my friend want to figure out who has the most toys? Without revealing how many toys they have?
They just want to steal each other's toys, so, yeah.
So, thanks, David.
Thank you.